From the WNIN Tri-State Public Media Center in downtown Evansville, I'm David James, and this is 2 Main Street. Okay, it's popcorn and pop culture as we go to the movies. So what are your favorite cult classics? The Rocky Horror Picture Show, Goonies, The Big Lebowski, Blazing Saddles, maybe The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai Across the Eighth Dimension. We'll hear a lot about that film in a moment. Or any Bruce Campbell flick. Army of Darkness, Bubba Hotep, or the Evil Dead series. Okay, I'm a Bruce Campbell fan. Okay, here to share their favorite cult films with us are two movie mavens, WFIE-TV film critic Ted Haycraft and Dwayne Todd, who is the author of the newly published book, The Buckaroo Banzai Collector's Compendium, A Marketing and Promotional Odyssey. That's a nice title. Okay, Ted and Dwayne, they both attended the Monsterama SpyCon in Atlanta where the Buckaroo Banzai Compendium debuted, and that was not too long ago. So guys, welcome, and let's define a cult film, and Dwayne, let's start with you.
All right, when I think about a cult film, I go back to the root of the word. So a cult is an obsession or a devotion to something. If you look in the actual dictionary, which I explored this in my book, it says it's a devotion to a personal person, a film, or other object. So for me, a cult film, really, the term has been watered down a lot. It gets thrown at all kinds of movies. But if you really want to think about it, there should be some type of really strong devotion by fans to the film that goes beyond, hey, I just kind of like this film. Nobody else does, but I like this. A couple of other things I think about a lot. The root of cult comes from the term for culture. So really, there's a culture associated with a cult film. Integrates itself or, you know, becomes part of what the fans are. So, like, when you think about a movie like Rocky Horror Picture Show, right, it's clearly, he jumps right out. There is a culture associated with that film. And so, consequently, that's how that becomes part of a really strong cult film. The third item I would throw out is it has its own language. So fans of the film speak to one another in a language, and I would talk about a little bit how Buckaroo Banzai incorporates every one of those pieces.
And a lot of these cult films don't do well at the box office, do they, Ted?
No, that's usually the sign of what ended up being a cult film. And you can't purposely make a cult film, even though people have tried. Like, for example, Rocky Horror Picture Show, they did a film called Shock Treatment as a follow-up. And they were going for that same, following and acceptance, but it didn't fly. And it's not really, I mean, the Rocky Horror Picture Show fans, I guess, yeah, Sort of embrace it, but no, but not that much. It's kind of forgotten. But yeah, I mean, I have these books I love. Before the digital age, the cult movies by Danny Perry. But what Dwayne said, it's been over abused and watered down, and is there a Wizard of Oz? Is that a cult film? Mm-hmm. Star Wars, Ghostbusters, because they're so big, they do have some of their own language. They do have cosplay, but I guess maybe there's sort of like different levels of cult films, and then you have another term for them sometimes, midnight movies.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's a whole interesting history there. It started with Eraserhead and Rocky Horror and The Night of Living Dead. They start showing in New York City at midnight, and they get a kind of a special category too, in a way.
Well, I think some of the fans that love these kind of movies, they don't want mass appeal, do they? They like to be in a certain group, maybe take that different road from the rest of society.
Part of the appeal is that it often is a counterculture.
Sure.
It's different from what's accepted as mainstream. Mm-hmm. So when I think about Star Wars, I mean, it's a prime example, because when it came out, legions of fans devoted going to see it. I personally saw it 23 times at the theater. It showed for a year here in Evansville,
Washington
for an entire
theater.
Year, one movie on. But back then, that was the only way you could see it. But nobody would call Star Wars a cult film, right? Because it transitioned to popular culture. In addition to those fans, people dress up You know, they have a culture of their own. If there's a 501st Legion of stormtroopers, there's people who do lightsaber battles, all in language. You know, you don't even have to have seen Star Wars to understand the reference, "I am your father," or "May the Force be with you," right? People know that without ever seeing the movie. So it has transitioned from what could have been cult to full-on popular culture.
A classic, I guess, then.
I would say the 77 one's a classic now. It's considered, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay, let's go to Buckaroo Banzai. You guys are big fans, of course.
Well, the first time I came on your show,
I know
you asked me for a top 10, and it was in my list, and you were baffled by it.
I had never heard of Buckaroo Banzai, The Adventures in the Eighth Dimension. I finally have seen the film. I've seen it twice now, and I think in your Monsterama panel, Dwayne, you described it as an unexplainable film to others. You just have to experience it.
Yep, that's exactly right. One of the biggest challenges they had with Buckaroo Banzai is that it's very difficult to explain. Mm-hmm. And so you see this in how they tried to market the film, how they tried to carry it out and, you know, catch and audiences. In fact, I have a kind of a behind-the-scenes memo that was circulated where they hired a company whose specialty is to bridge audiences and, you know, movies and books. And they said, this was their advice directly, they said, you cannot explain this movie to the audiences. It will only alienate them. What you need to do is talk about the cast.
Sure.
And talk about what they can expect to see, which is some science fiction elements, some comedy, and adventure types of things. It has this incredible cast, unbelievable when you look back at it. Peter Weller, John Lithgow, Jeff Goldblum, Christopher Lloyd, all of them rising stars. Ellen Barkin at the time, but they were established at that point. John Lithgow had been nominated for Academy Award. Peter Weller was very well established as an actor. They would go on to do even bigger things, but the movie pulled them into it. In repeated interviews, they would say they had a hard time getting through the script. Peter Weller said he was trying to read it and he couldn't get through it. But when he met the director and the director explained the movie, he's like, I was right on board. I wanted to be a part of this no matter what.
And a lot of it was enthusiasm, too.
Yes.
The director and the writer, their enthusiasm. Because Peter Weller, to this day, will say, I have no clue what this is about. But he loved, you know, but he's a great spokesman for it.
Now, before we go on, Dwayne, you have a partner here. Now, our radio audience, so explain your friend here.
So in the movie, there are aliens that dwell among us.
And you have a prop here of this alien.
And I have a prop that is a silicone casting of one of the alien heads. So it's a red lectroid is what they're called in the movie. So it has a reddish tint to it. Has some bulbous eyes. The design for the aliens actually came up. They were looking for something very unique. While they were sitting at dinner with the special effects, is what the way the story goes, they pulled a lobster off the table and said, hey, we should create something that looks like it's got the ridge back of the lobster starting at the nose where the tail would be and goes back across the forehead. So radio folks may want to Google this and, you know, try to find an image, but you can kind of see it as it works its way back here. It's a unique design for the aliens. It's even more interesting in the movie because they appear as normal people, normal humans.
And they're dressed in suits.
Dressed in bad business suits. Because
all their first names are John.
All their first names are John. These aliens came to the world, came to the United States in 1938 in Grover's Mill, New Jersey, when there was an interdimensional breakthrough that at first was War of the Worlds with Orson Welles. But then they hypnotized Orson Welles so that he said, aliens are invading. And then he said, no, it's just a radio show hoax.
Yeah, Orson denies it, though.
There is a note from his estate that he denies whether that ever happened.
Yeah.
And these electroids?
Yeah.
They like junk food? Is that right?
That's right. They have become spoiled. They are Originally, some of the most evil creatures in the galaxy dwelling on planet 10. I know this is getting way out there.
It's unexplainable. Yeah.
They come onto the planet Earth, and they set up a company and start doing military contracts, which flows into 80s politics. Around the Cold War and Cold War efforts. They get spoiled by eating junk food, really sugary treats like Twinkies, Fiddle Faddle, and you see them in the movie eating these things, and so it's softened their warrior physique, so they're not quite as strong of fighters as they once were, and in fact, as the movie progresses, John, the leader of the group, John Lithgow, wants to go back to their home world and take it back over. And a lot of them are like, nah, maybe we should just stay right here because it's pretty comfy life right here on Earth.
And like you said, they had military contracts. And speaking of Orson Welles again, did you notice the actor, Ronald Lacey, playing the president of the United States, looks like Orson Welles and kind of sounds like Orson. Think about it. I mean, that's on purpose. Obviously, you get this whole Orson Welles connection going on. It's hilarious. And then Ronald Lacey is interesting because he's in Raiders of the Lost Ark. You don't even recognize him because of his makeup for the park.
And there's one scene in the movie where the John Lithgow character tries to go into this other dimension, but he gets stuck in the wall. And when he's pulled out, that's when he's really crazed.
Right.
And then he kind of does like a Three Stooges thing with these guys, like bumps their heads together. It's just, there's kind of kinds of homages in this film.
Yes. You see a lot of influences from everything from 2001, A Space Odyssey. So when you see the ships, you see the stewardess walking one direction and with a tray of food. It is odd scene. There's a whole sequence that's very lifted from The Outer Limits, Architects of Fear. The right stuff. If you watch the opening scene there, it has that feel of the beginning of The Right Stuff, where Chuck Yeager is preparing to break the sound barrier at the beginning of this movie. Buckaroo Banzai is preparing to break the dimensional barrier,
going through a mountain with his jet
. So,
and there's even a comic book references. And they even got a very famous comic book artist, Mike Kaluta, to do a cover for when the book. I go, that's the Buckaroo Banzai comic, you know.
The latest issue.
Well, we're talking about Buckaroo Banzai, this cult. I guess you guys would call it a cult classic because you're big fans, aren't you?
Obviously. I even get my T-shirt on, you know.
I know. You're really into it. Now, let's learn more about my guests. Of course, Ted's been on the show before. We know about Ted. He does movie reviews for WFIE-TV. He's a director, works at Channel 14. He's been there for forever.
Quite a while, 1980s.
When
it was filmed.
A veteran. Now, Dwayne Todd, you're native of Evansville?
Yes.
All right. And I know you have a kind of an interesting past. You have an engineering background.
Yes.
And you worked for a laboratory. And now you're into the book business. Is that
that's
right?
That's correct.
That's an interesting path.
Yes. But all along the way, I started out in engineering, studying, researching, worked for a lab. Then I actually worked for Alcoa for quite a few years here locally. And in there, I was able to work on a lot of groundbreaking research on consumer options in the energy markets. I published a number of papers about that. As I retired from Alcoa, I was one of my goals for many years was to put together a history about Buckaroo Banzai, among other things. So I really tried to approach it like I did any other research project, where you study the subject, study a lot of the source materials. I read over 200 articles for it, original scripts, pre-development scripts, a lot of behind-the-scenes stuff, and then worked on compiling that down into conclusions about things they were doing and why there's all this variety of marketing materials that exist that I've always found fascinating. And Ted as well. Ted's collected these. Over the years,
I thought I was a good collector. Dwayne made me look like an amateur, but that's what was so wonderful about this is to see this whole thing evolve. Because at Owensboro a few years back, this little film convention, they brought in Peter Weller for charitable reasons, and they showed Buckaroo Banzai there, and Peter was signing autographs and stuff, and I said, you know, we need to get Dwayne. You got all this wonderful stuff, and Peter Weller, Buckaroo himself, is going to be there. Why don't you see if we can get you set up here at the table and show all your stuff off? So that was, and he sure, I don't know, did Peter ever get to see it? Did he walk by?
I think he saw some of it, yeah. And I had some of the blueprints that he actually signed from the set.
Oh, and even better, when the screening came and Peter introduced it, the Electroid showed up. Yeah. He dressed up and so the suit and tie and the whole thing and sat there. And I think Peter
walked in and said, "There they are, evil, pure and simple, away the eighth dimension."
Had you started the book before that? Or
no.
Yeah, and so from there, just kind of like all of a sudden, I've seen this thing, you know, grow and grow and grow, and it's amazing, his collection, and you'll see a bulk of it in this book.
Mm-hmm. And I think what I really tried to do is I love sharing the stuff. You know, yeah. Like here's all these different pieces, but then it's like, well, why? What's the fascination? Why is it interesting? And so then in the research, you know, the story begins to evolve. From the concept, where they came up with the original concept, how they pulled all the actors in, how they sold this story, you know, who would have bought this thing? And they even say, "I can't believe anybody bought this story." They while they're making the movie.
Tell them what the producer wanted, thought he had.
Certainly the producer, David Beagleman, who gave the ultimate green light for the movie, he believed he had the next Indiana Jones. this is going to be, they signed the actors for 5 movies. This is going to be, you know, a phenomenon across the entire country.
Merchandising out the, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was going to, he had sold it to investors that way. And it led to a lot of conflicts on set when he started to see what they were filming. And he's like, "This doesn't look like it doesn't look like Indiana Jones or Star Wars. This is like nothing I've ever seen before." And so.
And he got pretty mad about it. It's a long history about that.
Well, how much does it, like $9 million to make or something like 10 million?
12 million. It was the 12 million was the original budget, but back then,
what year are we talking?
1983 was when they filmed.
Okay,
it was released in 1984. But similar movies that same summer, you had Ghostbusters came out. Star Trek III, Temple of Doom had just recently been out, and those were in the $25 to $30 million range. So you got to always kind of take it with a little bit of grain of salt that, you know, they really do an amazing job given what, you know, the cast that they pulled in. They don't have one or two great actors. They have an ensemble of people. And then they do some really great special effects that really work within the film.
And yet we get critics or people that will slag it just because, like, well, look at the budget here, or look at the warehouse, some of the things they tend to point out. Which
And the film didn't make the budget, did it?
No, it was a bomb. It made about $6 million domestically.
I didn't think it was going to even play here. I had Jim Alexander, my best friend, and I went up to Terre Haute to see it.
Okay.
It barely even showed up here. Mm-hmm. I only played 1 week.
Now, Peter Weller, the star who played Buckaroo.
Yeah.
Now, RoboCop, did that follow this?
Yes.
Okay. All right.
It came out about 2 years later.
Yeah, they saw him. Shoot
the Moon,
which is one of my favorite films. It's very depressing. It's about divorce. Mm-hmm. And I dragged my family to that. And they were like, "Why did you drag us to this film?" But it's really Diane Keaton and Albert Finney. It's a wonderful film. Alan Parker directed it, who just passed away. But they saw Peter Weller in a small part in there, and that's what got him the part. Well, at least.
He was a stage actor. He was a well-established stage actor at that point as well.
There's also a Buckaroo Banzai book and comic book, too?
Yes, there have been some comic books.
At the time the movie came out, there was a novelization.
Oh, yeah, the adaptation.
And a comic book adaptation, both of which are essential viewing and reading for the movie, because the screenplay writer, Errol MacRoush, who created the character, he'd been working on this character for about 8 years when it was finally made into a movie. The character was originally called Buckaroo Bandy. And as he described this wandering Texas minstrel to W.D. Richter's like, "Hey, I will pay you to develop this into a screenplay." And so he worked on various screenplays. So now you have in the archives, you have this history of these different screenplays that he developed, completely different stories, each one of them kind of like an adventure that Buckaroo Banzai would have went on.
If I can interject real quick, there was a, he said the Singing Minstrel, there was a serial. Do you, David, you might remember this, maybe not, Gene Autry serial. Yeah. But it's science fiction setting. Gene Autry, what was that?
So the Phantom Empire.
Yeah, Phantom Empire.
Okay,
and,
I've heard that.
And the director said, this is the number one influence. So Gene Autry played a cowboy. He plays himself. He's a singing
cowboy.
It's very
strange.
He's on a ranch. It's the radio show Ranch. And he has to do a radio show program every single day at a certain hour. If he doesn't, he loses the ranch. All right? So he's got his band, and they come every day. They get into adventures along the way. Well, they discover that there's an empire of advanced civilization living 5 miles beneath the earth who have robots, ray guns. The robots have cowboy hats.
Again, this is a Gene Autry serial.
Gene Autry serial, 13 episodes. It's fantastic. My. It's so much fun. Well, Buckaroo Banzai, and I don't think we've really explained this too much, but Buckaroo Banzai is kind of like a modern-day Leonardo da Vinci, where he does a whole host
of
things.
He's a Renaissance guy.
Renaissance
guy. Rock and roll singer.
He's a modern-day Gene Autry, to some extent. He's a scientist. He has a rock and roll band. We get to hear some great 80s music inside of Buckaroo Banzai that was kind of on the cutting edge at that point. He's very fashion-forward. He's a neurosurgeon, a race car driver. He designs science experiments. But he's perfectly normal, a normal human being. He doesn't have any superpowers. He's just kind of doing the best that he can do as a human. But more importantly, and I think this is the appeal, his whole focus is getting other people better. So in the movie, he develops, like, Jeff Goldblum's character is very insecure. He's very unsure of himself at the beginning. Buckaroo brings him into the team, inspires him, and by the end of the movie, Jeff Goldblum's a strong character. He has confidence. He's helping save the world.
Jeff Goldblum, the New Jersey Cowboy.
Yeah, New Jersey Cowboy.
Well, he thought, you know, Cavaliers, he thought, I need to dress up.
Yeah. Hong Kong Cavaliers.
Is the group, is Buckaroo's inner circle in the band. And he shows up thinking that he needs to be in uniform. And the other Buckaroo Banzai guys go, and they call him New Jersey. And it's kind of funny. But Goldblum, I love the fact that you open up, you see near the beginning of the film, Buckaroo's doing brain surgery on an Eskimo with Jeff Goldblum. And then he says, have you thought about joining the team? And he goes, can you sing? And Jeff goes, no, but I can dance. I mean, it's little lines like that, too.
And that's part of the language.
Yeah.
So Buckaroo Banzai fans, that line will come up over and over when you're talking to someone. It's just an inside little joke there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, let's talk about John Lithgow.
Oh,
you talked about the other character. Ellen Barkin's in it. Very good.
You a Breaking Bad? Have you seen Breaking Bad?
Oh, yeah.
Do you recognize Jonathan Banks?
No.
When Lithgow leaves the hospital he's encased in, he takes the guy out. The guy that stops him?
Yes.
That's Jonathan Banks from Breaking Bad.
He's Mike. Great in that.
Yeah. Small little part.
Oh, I know it. He's like his keeper at the asylum.
Where are you going, Doc? The moon? No, Planet 10.
And there's all kinds. Well, anyway, I'm going off on a tangent, too.
Lithgow.
You're at. Okay, Lithgow. Let's go. Before we go to Lithgow, you're an engineering guy, Dwayne.
Yes.
And there's all kinds of gadgets in this film. And the Lithgow, he puts this gadget on his mouth and everything and goes back into the past. And it's kind of gauges and everything flashing around.
So electroids in the movie like to consume electricity. So that's just one of the aspects. So there's actually a scene where one of them has a car battery and he's got the... a straw, and they cut a line out of it. It's in the deleted scenes because the producers were afraid it would make the aliens too comical. We were talking a minute ago about whether they're really evil or they're kind of like the Three Stooges. But there's a line where he offers the battery, and he's like, "Here, you want to hit on this battery?" And Christopher Lloyd says, "No, I'm cutting back." But they cut that out. But the electroids consume sugary substances and electricity.
Well, of course.
And so that gives him a boost of energy, literally and figuratively, and allows him to kind of remember his past. But they consume.
He's kind of a tragic character too, because I've always thought Dr. Lizardo was a scientist trying to do what Buckaroo Banzai's dad was doing, trying to break into the, go through the solid matter. Mm-hmm. And then, but he got infected by John.
Yes. So when he crosses over into the eighth dimension.
Dr. Lizardo is the John Lithgow character.
Yes.
Yes. But
Italian scientist.
Dr. Lizardo is an Italian scientist. When he goes in, Lizardo is an alien and he takes over his brain. So now you have is actually a human. If it's not confusing enough, he's actually a human with a electroid living inside of him. And they say that there's someone living inside of him.
Yeah.
And
people listening to this right now are just probably driving off the road. If they're please stay on the road, folks.
But trust me, he's kind of, like I said, he was kind of a scientist working along with Buckaroo Banzai's father and assistants and stuff. And then he gets inhabited by this bad alien.
And he even makes the line at one point, if there's one thing I cannot stand, it's to be mistaken for somebody else. Well, obviously, the only thing that ever happens is he's mistaken for someone else because he's in the body of a different person.
Yeah.
So it's this bizarre humor, mm-hmm, that's just all through the movie.
Now, Lithgow, they must have just given him free rein to go bonkers on this film.
Oh, yeah. What did you I was watching some of it. Did he listen to some Mussolini?
That's part of the inspiration.
Yeah,
for
because
it.
If you he does this big speech near the end. It's
yes.
Just, and if you watch it, you're thinking it's Mussolini. It's
he's up on a podium and everything.
Gestures and everything.
They have all the big signs hanging up and things like that. I do think a lot of what turned me on early in this film is I was in engineering, studying engineering. There's a lot of science behind the film itself. So even though we say driving through a solid matter, that doesn't make any sense. But there's actually a whole scientific superstring theory that talks about how it would be possible to move through objects. The writer, Errol MacRoush, he's very, very, very intelligent. There's some science behind all the pieces that happen inside of the film. So I think that brings a great aspect to it.
I think also that it's nice. It was a breakaway from we're so used to starships, the Star Wars type, the 2001 type, the Star Trek type. The ships in this are like taken off from the sea.
Yeah,
I can't. What's the word I'm looking for?
Organic,
organic and crustacean. I'm not. But very
coral. It looks like coral or a seashell.
Something you'd find on the beach. These ships, and it's like a really. That's really cool too. It may not be to your liking. We're so trained to like these really slick starships, but to see something like this is another interesting aspect.
When they're setting at little cocktail tables, too.
Yeah. That's the good. The black electroids.
Yeah.
There's two different electroids, and that's the good.
But
ones.
In the design, they definitely were trying to get. They wanted something that was completely different.
So it is definitely completely different for the
ships, the aliens, and the ship designs are very fascinating.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, let's go to some other cult movies now. I think we've got everybody just kind of really scratching their heads about Buckaroo Banzai, which they should. I mean, you have to see it. You can't explain it to folks. Okay, other cult movies. Fan favorites. I've seen some lists of fan favorites. Of course, Rocky Horror Picture Show's up there, Big Lebowski, Blazing Saddles, among other top vote-getters. Are there others worth watching besides those? I'm sure you have some favorites.
Well, let me just talk about, we were talking about that earlier. We were talking about the definition of cults. Lebowski's an interesting one because there's a lot of people that still haven't seen that of the Coen Brothers film, and they do bowling. They get together for bowling across the country, bowling events. For Big Lebowski, because of the bowling.
Right,
So that's a good example. I'm trying to think of a really interesting one off the beaten path because, like I said, there's a lot of obvious ones or people think they're cult films. I would say Local Hero would be one I would recommend as a kind of a cult classic. It's Peter Wiegert, who was in Animal House, and I don't know where else people would know him from, and Amy Irving. and Burt Lancaster. It's one of the latter-day Burt Lancaster films. And this guy is sent from a corporation from Texas to go buy up land in Scotland for an oil refinery. And he gets sucked into the land and the people that he has to buy the town. And there's all these little eccentric characters, and they're Wedge from Star Wars. What's his name, the actor?
But he's Derek Hagen.
Yeah.
Hagen.
No, not Wedge, the other one. Gosh. Anyway, one of the starfighters from Star Wars, he's an actor in this thing. He's Ewan McGregor's uncle.
Oh, yeah. Eric Larson.
Yeah, Larson, yeah. But anyway, I'm babbling here. But anyway, it has a following, and it has – I think there's like one phone booth in the town that he's trying to buy up, and he has to call Burt Lancaster on to give him reports. So they've actually painted and put a phone booth in that town to go sue it. And there's a Facebook page devoted to it, and there's a really core group that just love this film. And I remember people walking out when I saw it at East Park. It's a beautiful little gentle film, and I think that's kind of a cult film.
So, Dwayne, what are some of your favorite cult classics?
I have to go with a couple of, standards. Night of the Living Dead, the original, is from the time I first saw it. It is actually considered, and I know that's a kind of like a mainstream cult film, but it was one of the first films that worked into midnight showings in this notion of where in the 70s, you didn't have the flexibility, all the options of watching things at home. So if you wanted to see it, you'd go to the theater. So they started showing this over and over and over. Audiences would come in to see it. It becomes just such an iconic symbol of all the things that are happening inside that movie.
And from that film, we have the zombie stuff. Yeah, the
influences are just unreal.
Zombie apocalypse is the common language now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right.
And they might have never saw Night of the Living Dead.
Yeah.
And there's cult films in each genre, westerns, comedies, yes, horror.
Well, everybody talks about, the Fistful of Dollars, $3 more good than the ugly Leone. I'm going back, one of my loves, Leone. But a lot of people haven't seen his masterpiece, the fourth Western he did, Once Upon a Time in the West, with Charles Bronson. And that's kind of overlooked, and that's kind of got its interesting own little cult following, because it's such a unique feeling, looking, pacing, everything about that film is so unique and stands the test of time.
Mm-hmm.
I'll throw in another film, The Day the Earth Caught Fire. Probably not one you've seen.
I have not heard that.
Liam O'Kern.
Leo Kern, Janet Monroe. So the Earth has shifted off of its axis. It's starting to move towards the sun slowly. The Earth starts to heat up, all these natural disasters. The film is set in a newspaper office. And so it goes through the newspapers trying to understand what's going on, how can we counter this, the reactions of all the people. The main character, he's gone through a divorce. He doesn't have custody of his son. But he's kind of given up on life. And as he's studying what's happening to the earth and he sees all these things, he finds inspiration to live and move forward. Great, great film. That's actually the next article I'm working on, is digging into this. It's one of the first disaster movies, 1962. It was originally, so you see all these title things happening, or a society beginning to collapse, because there's this awareness in 4 weeks the Earth will have moved close enough that we're all dead. So they attempt to set off these bombs to get us back on track. Society, everyone reacts differently inside of the film. So I would throw that one out there as one I really, really like. A lot of interesting aspects to it.
He makes a good point, too. That's a film that I think was off the radar for a long time. But because of DVD and Blu-rays, and there's all these boutique companies out there that are run by fanatics like us, and they know these things are out there, and they're putting out special editions of these really strange, obscure, than that, and that's more of a mainstream film. What his is, I mean, it's not really that way offbeat, but it was sort of, and we're getting like, the Andy Warhol films and all these, and Paul Naschy is a Spanish, he likes to dress up as a wolfman in the Wolfman movies in Spain, and Jesse Franco and what's Mario Bava, a big giant book done on him. These things are coming out on special editions loaded up with extras for a film that's really kind of an exploitation film, or kind of like you would watch and go, this is kind of bad, you know, but there's these just feverish followers for it, mm-hmm. and they're getting better editions than a mainstream film does on Blu-ray. It's amazing.
Well, I think B-movies, too,
make
great cult classics. And, of course, the Atomic Age launched all these movies about these monsters and all the crazy stuff that goes on and with radioactivity.
Yeah. Incredible Shrinking Man.
It just came out on Criterion this week.
I saw that. Oh. And that one there, I can watch it over and over. It's so fascinating and fun. It's just a lot of fun to watch.
Yeah. Yeah, and you've got to, on some of these, the B films, the exploitation films, part of the fandom for it is because you got to change your perspective watching it. You're not going into a David Lean film. You're not going to a Stanley Kubrick film. You got somebody who's working on a low budget, doing the best he can, really putting all his energy. I mean, that's why kind of now Ed Wood's kind of revered, mm-hmm. Plan 9 from Outer Space. You know, everybody thought that was just a piece of crud. But now you watch it and you go, no, you kind of enjoy it because you know Ed Wood's story. And you know Ed's, he just wanted to make movies. He just wanted to make these movies. And he'd get Bela Lugosi and he's, you know, got drug problems and Tor Johnson and an old wrestler, you know, and Vampira. And it's just amazing when you watch it and you enjoy it and you want to know more about it. And you just keep wanting to read more and find out about it.
Now, in the compendium, Duane, you have Buckaroo Collectibles. Is that correct?
That's right. So one of the great things, I mean, not so great, but the great thing is that there's not a lot of them produced at the time the movie came out.
Because it's a one-shot movie.
So it was intended to be a bunch, but there was only one. They had a hard time selling the movie to people who wanted to merchandise it. So we have some ViewMaster slides. They did some interesting things. They knew they had to have a different approach to marketing the film. So ahead of the film at conventions, they produced 35,000 headbands. So these are a yellow and red headband with a Japanese symbol on it that says Beauty in Everyday Life. Buckaroo Banzai wears this in one of the key moments of the film. And they gave these out to convention attendees to promote the film. So they're fairly rare, even though there's a lot of them out there. When we were down in Atlanta last weekend, a number of people came up to me and said, yeah, I still have my headband. Here it is. I got this at the Atlanta Fantasy Fair in 1984 when they were handing them out, showing clips and things from the movie. And so I think the collectibles become very unique. They made a little toy, a magical jet car toy. I know on the radio you can't see it, but it's a little circle, and it's got the car, and it's a magic trick that was produced by a little a mom-and-pop toy store that did novelty toys in New York. They optioned the license and produced this thing for the film. And so, but somehow they said, I love this film. It's so unique. I want to do something really unique relative to the film.
That's very unique.
That is. Where'd you get that?
I got on a mail order at the time. There was a mail order of some Buckaroo Banzai, and I bought an entire box of these. So it was a box of 12. It came in a really nice container, and I gave most of them
away.
You
gave one to me. I saw it right away. I go, oh, I want one. And Duane, being gracious enough, gave me one.
And over the years, I've given out to somebody who really loves the film. You know, I think it's just fantastic to share that type of thing.
We have a kind of a cranium type item here. And so, explain that to everybody.
Inside the film, one of the...
This was underneath the vehicle, wasn't it?
Yeah,
this
so thing? As Buckaroo drives through the mountain, he comes out the other side, he finds a creature has attached itself to the drivetrain of his Ford F-150 pickup truck, which is what he uses to go through the mountain. And he pulls it off. And the significance is that he makes in the film is you could pulverize the mountain, go through all of the crumbs, and you would never find this life form. But this life form came out of the eighth dimension with him. And so this is a casting from a prop from the movie. I painted it myself. A lot of fans, you know, will have the masks or other props associated with the film. It's a great fun way to collect different types of things or unique things because it's kind of handmade.
And of course, this film, Buckaroo Banzai, Adventures in the Eighth Dimension, was marketed overseas as well. Did it do very well overseas?
It did have some success in a few countries. So in the United States, when the film was completed, 20th Century Fox looked at it and said, this is really bizarre. We're taking control of it. So they gave it to a marketing team that came up with a marketing campaign that shows Buckaroo in a yuppie suit, a casual suit, nothing like what he wears in the film. It shows a spaceship blasting out of a brick wall that looks nothing like any spaceship in the movie. Remember, the alien ships are organic looking. They look like coral. This thing is a rectangular square mechanical ship. When the director saw the poster, he said, I've never seen a poster that looks less like the movie than this poster looks like. And so when you look at it, you think, is this representative of the film, which is what you want to catch? And it really isn't. When they went to release it internationally, they went to a company called Producer Sales Association, which is an organization which specializes in taking movies and translating them to other countries. So if you had a hard time translating it to American audiences, imagine translating it to a German or French audience. But they created entirely different marketing campaigns. So in Germany, they have a silhouette of Buckaroo. It's all black with a green highlight behind it.
Yeah, we have the poster here.
We have the poster here. It's very mysterious. And if you can imagine living in...
Ted, why don't you get that poster here?
You can imagine living in Germany in 1984... The year George Orwell's novel, 1984, was set, you had a divided Germany at that point in time. Mm-hmm. So you had a lot of mysterious, paranoia types of things. And so this poster, and even the phrase up here, there are aliens living among us. They can see you, and they use the German word for you personally. They can see you, but you cannot see them, okay? And so... Using some of these types of things, they tried to connect to that audience. It's very, very different than what it is in the U.S. Even the what's called lobby cards. So these are pictures from the film. They are posted in the lobby in promotional pictures. Use very different images than in the U.S. They show the hangar bay. They show the science experiments. They show Buckaroo hooked up to this technology. They emphasize the industrialization, and they emphasize the science behind it, which would have appealed to a German audience. They don't use those pictures in the U.S. promotion at all. Spring forward to France. France has the most interesting of the posters, and I'm not sure why you would connect.
Wait. Yeah. David, does that remind you of anything?
Looks like RoboCop.
Well, RoboCop is one aspect. Is there another? I'm thinking, I'll give you a hint, Mel Gibson.
Oh, yes.
Road Warrior.
Yes, it is a Road Warrior.
Mad Max, especially, yeah.
Yeah. Oh. So if you're on the radio, this is a character who's completely in all black leather outfit and a gun that's almost as big as what he is.
Nothing like that in the movie.
Yeah, it never appears in the film. So they were targeting the violent aspects in this futuristic to appeal to that audience. The lobby cards in France, very different images. In fact, over half of the images show guns being brandished. So an Uzi or a 9mm, different guns, which is not really a core part of the movie.
No, not at all.
In the U.S., you see no guns in the lobby cards. In Germany, only in a couple. But here, there's these violent images. They show, there's one where Penny is being wrestled to the ground. They were trying to...
I don't know what it says about the French, but...
Appeal to violence, the apocalyptic aspect, those types of things.
Now, was the film rated then at one time? Did they have ratings then?
Yes, so PG.
It was a PG? Okay.
Yes, in the U.S., and it was rated for 15 and above overseas.
Okay. So. All right, before I forget, let's talk about Bruce Campbell films. And I understand, Dwayne, you have met Bruce Campbell.
I sure did.
The B-movie star.
Yes, so he was at a convention. I had the opportunity to – I was actually on the front row of a panel with him and got to listen to his personality. In real life, he's very much like the personality he plays in a lot of his films. And one of the big things I remember really well, he talked about a couple of things, but he talked about his favorite movie of all time and favorite actor, and that was Bridge on the River Kwai with – William Holden. He said William Holden is, no hands down, his favorite actor. He loved Bridge on the River Kwai because of the practical effects. He's like, you know, he's like, I just can't believe they blew this. They built a bridge. They blew a bridge up, a real bridge. You don't get a second shot. You only want one chance actually, to blow the bridge up.
Well, actually, that's not totally correct because in Good, Bad, and the Ugly, they had the bridge scene at the end. And Sergio was going to give the mayor or somebody as a dignitary to say that give the command to blow the bridge. It was said early the cameras were not rolling and the bridge blew up, so they had to build it all again.
Oh my
and
God.
Shoot it again. Wow. But that shows you the budget and power that Leone had. Well, Lean had power too there,
but Bruce Campbell, I mean, I was a huge, huge fan growing up.
Are you too, David? Because you're the one who brought it. What brought you the Bruce Campbell?
Well, I think the Army of Darkness was a good one.
The third one. That's the
Well, when's the one where he goes back in time.
If you watch them in order, it's Evil Dead, Evil Dead 2, and then Army of Darkness, because you need to watch the Evil Dead, the second one, to see how he gets where he gets.
Right.
But know what you're going to say? I didn't mean to interrupt you there.
Well, and he has the chainsaw for his arm.
Oh, yeah. That happens groovy. In the second movie. The first two are pretty dark and violent, the Evil Dead and Evil Dead 2, and including where he cuts his arm off and puts a chainsaw on there. But then at the end of the second movie, he wakes up in the Middle Ages. They wanted to break from the horror aspect of Evil Dead 1 and 2 and said, we're going to make a brand new Army of Darkness and kind of create it as its own standalone movie, which it does work very well as its own.
Yeah, of course, now, do you realize how much more of Ash, Bruce Campbell, that's his character's name, Ash, how much more stuff there is out there of him?
No.
There's a TV series.
TV series, comic books. He's crossing over with Vampirella or some of the other characters. I don't know. It's crazy out there.
But I'll tell you, an interesting connect this to Buckaroo Banzai. Bruce Campbell was on a TV show called Briscoe County Jr. And he was a...
Very highly recommend it.
If you like him, he's a cowboy, and he has these kind of comedic adventures. It has the feel of Buckaroo Banzai. There's little science. There's all these things going on, and I think there was some cross writing. There's a few jokes show up across there as well.
Yeah,
I'd have to go back and look, but definitely that same brand of humor.
Okay, Bubba Hotep, strange movie with Bruce Campbell. He plays Elvis,
maybe
well, he thinks he's Elvis.
Yeah,
and he's in a nursing facility, and. And it's just strange. And another good actor in there, too.
Oh, yeah.
It's been a while since.
Yeah, it's been a while since I've seen it, too. Yeah. Is that just something you stumbled across one night?
Well, I stumbled across that. And then there's some kind of a Egyptian entity that's killing people in the facility. Nursing. And he tries to solve this mystery. And
thing about Bruce Campbell I like, too, is that he ends up. He turns up in all these low budget.
Ozzie Davis.
Oh, Ozzie. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, Ozzie Davis is in it. That's
and he turns up in these exploitation films and lower films or cult films that become cult classics or whatever. But every once in a while, he'll show up in a really mainstream, a budget film. And he's also good buddies with Sam Raimi, who did the Evil Dead. And well, Sam's good buddies, the Coen brothers. So Bruce Campbell, I think he's shown up at least once in a Coen Brothers film. But I always love it when Bruce shows up in a bigger film. And you get to see that, no, he's a good actor. He tends to be like, Bruce Campbell, funny, ha-ha. He's an evil dad, he's Ash, whatever. But no, he's a lot of fun.
He showed up in the Spider-Man movies.
Yes.
Sam Raimi's Spider-Man movies. And I don't know if he will be in the upcoming Doctor Strange.
Oh,
but,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
It'll be interesting to see if he makes an appearance, because it's pretty normal for him to appear in a Sam Raimi movie.
Yes.
Now, are there some movies that are just too bizarre to sit through that you would not recommend cult films?
Well, I just saw, I mean, I saw one recently that I would say a lot of people would just go, Ted, you're crazy. Mandy, Nicolas Cage. Nicolas Cage, that's a whole hour devoted there. Because his career is just, it's almost, that's almost under, insane. Career.
Oh, that's a whole program.
That's a whole program.
It is.
But he'll every time I turn around at Walmart, I see a new Nicolas Cage film at Walmart. This one's called Mandy, and it just goes off the rails and goes cuckoo. And it's really bizarre, but it's wonderful. But it's wonderful to me. I know another one is Ryan Gosling did that film Drive.
Drive, yeah.
But the follow up, Only God Forgives. If you got, and the same director, same Ryan Gosling. If people thought, oh, I like Drive, I'm gonna go see this one. Oh, they're gonna be running out of the theaters. But I love it when a director has a really crazy vision. And he drives it over the cliff, and you just go with him. But you have to go with him over the cliff. If you don't want to go over the cliff, then, you know, it can be really, you know.
Oh, this Nicolas Cage movie gets in my head right now, Bad Lieutenant.
Oh, that's, yeah.
And he was, like, in New Orleans, and it just goes off the rails.
Which is a really weird, that's a Herzog film. That's actually one of the better ones, believe it or not. And it's kind of a weird follow-up to the first Bad Lieutenant, which was Harvey Keitel, and that wasn't even got. That's kind of got a cult status too.
Okay.
Well, speaking of The Color Out of Space.
Oh, that's the other one. Right around the same time Mandy came out.
Fantastic adaptation. It stars Nicolas Cage. Adaptation of H.P. Lovecraft's story, a horror story, which are very difficult to do because he's a very psychological writer. That movie, dead on, really, I recommend. It's not one of them that I would say, no, stay away from. If you like that type, I would definitely recommend that.
But
well done. And not Nicolas Cage.
There are gems in there.
He's a toned-down Nicolas Cage. Sometimes you get him, and he's just like all out. Oh, you know, yeah, he's playing Nicolas Cage.
But I have, you know, I have a good group of friends that love movies, love cinema. And a couple of them just now saw Buck Rubanza because I kept on, you know, bludgeoning him with it.
Sure.
And then they were like, "Yeah, it's okay." You know, I mean, it's like, no, don't you get it? You know, you got to love it, you know.
Well, and I'll mention that when the film came out, and I cover this in the book, Film Review Magazine, which was compiled at that time. It's a over 1,000 film reviewers, and they put all the statistics. It's like the Rotten Tomatoes of today. Mm-hmm. Put the statistics together, it was split almost perfectly. One third really liked it, one third said, "Eh," one third hated it. And I would say from a lot of audiences with Buckaroo Banzai and a lot of these types of movies, that's the type of, you know, you get a real split on whether or not someone's going to like it.
And that maybe brands it as a cult movie then.
Exactly.
Definitely. Now, okay, before we wrap this up, the closing scene in Buckaroo Banzai, the closing credits, it's just strange. They're walking through some kind of a drainage area.
Which is used a lot in L.A. If you watch a lot of Hollywood films.
Yeah, they have a lot of races and stuff.
Terminator and just all kinds of stuff.
End of
all the concrete.
Greece. End of Greece. It's the aqueducts. And
yeah, that's right.
A drainage area. In End of Greece, they do their drag strip racing down through there.
The producer didn't like the film. Tell him what this is an interesting story about.
So as the film wrapped up, I'll spoil the ending to some extent. The ending ends with the alien Buckaroo kissing, his love interest, and the alien just says, "So what? Big deal." And so that was the end of the movie. And the producer's like, you can't end a movie on such a sour, bizarre note.
And they announced there was going to be another one. Announcement for
coming
another
soon.
Film. Coming soon.
Buckaroo Banzai Against the World Crime League.
But to have an alien say that, it's like, what?
And so the producer's like, we got to put something upbeat in this, okay? And so they actually called everybody back. All the cast came back, and they developed this end march. And initially, they marched to the tune of "Uptown Girl" by Billy Joel, and so they you'll see them kind of rappel down the sides, And then as Buckaroo's walking, he's joined, his team assembles, all these people come into the team from the side, and they're just marching along to the beat. Billy Vera is just an incredible musician. This is one of his first starring roles. He does this little twist. His stage presence comes out, so he's walking along and he does this little twist with his feet.
One character changes outfits in the middle. And one character is technically dead.
Yes, I remember that.
I don't want to spoil anything, but in case you're going to watch this, folks.
But it is the most fun ending you could ever see.
It really is.
You can just Google it and watch that ending.
Mm-hmm.
The song is fantastic all the way around.
It's just that I think it almost makes it elevates the film to
me. It does.
And I think of one of the most iconic moments. And then, and to show its influence, Wes Anderson, of all people, puts that at the end of Life of Aquatic with Bill Murray. Bill Murray and the cast at the end of that film did their little march at the end credits of that film.
That's another strange movie.
So,
that really is. Well, guys, this has been great fun. My guests have been Dwayne Todd. He's author of the Buckaroo Banzai Collector's Compendium and movie reviewer Ted Haycraft. Thanks for this wild ride with Buckaroo Banzai.
David, all I have to say is no matter where you go, there you are.
There you go. We'll end with that. Thanks, guys. This has been a lot of fun. I'm David James. This is 2 Main Street, presented by Jeffrey Berger of Berger Wealth Services at Bayard Private Wealth Management.